Hi, everyone. Despite giving us timeless, fun, and inspiring pieces of music, the Origipop era was also one of prejudice and bias. As we've already seen in my video on the racist roots and repercussions of Origipop, these negative aspects of society existed in and were often amplified by many Origipop songs, some of which are still well known today. But in addition to simply being present in Origipop songs, these prejudices impacted the creation of this music by affecting who could write these songs in the first place. Although there were minorities in the songwriting industry, especially among the Jewish population, who were well represented by such famous composers and lyricists as Irving Berlin, Oscar Hammerstein II, Jerome Kern, and the Gershwin brothers, it was much harder for members of other marginalized groups to make it in. Unsurprisingly, given their exclusion from almost every other professional sphere, women were vastly underrepresented within the songwriting profession, despite many songs being written about, marketed to, and performed by women. It is unfortunately a fact that, due to society's expectations and the rigid mores of the day, there were fewer female songwriters during the Origipop era than their male counterparts. However, this does not mean that they did not exist, or that they wrote music that was somehow inferior. On the contrary, there are perhaps many more female songwriters from this period than is widely known, and some of their songs were massive hits in their day and are still recognizable even today. So today, in celebration of Women's History Month, let's take a look at some of these women, explore the world and society in which they wrote, and analyze their contributions to original popular music and how they helped open the door for future female songwriters. And to start, I want to mention that there are actually so many female songwriters, I won't be able to cover them all. In fact, according to research by Christopher Reynolds, professor of music at my alma mater, the University of California, Davis, between 1890 and 1930 in the United States and England, more than 26,000 songs were published by 5,347 women. Now, not all of this is strictly original popular music, but the sheer number of female composers and songs they published, in addition to preventing me from covering them all, also helped to refute the prevalent idea of the era that women just couldn't write music as well as men. This opinion was one of the many contemporary attitudes that inhibited female songwriters and against which they had to constantly struggle and work to overcome. We can see this sentiment articulately expressed in the 1880 book Woman in Music, written by music critic and journalist George Putnam Upton. In his book, Upton acknowledges that women are excellent performers of music, primarily as singers, but also through the playing of instruments. He calls them the great queens of song, whose sway is everywhere acknowledged. However, when it comes to writing music, he says that women have failed to create important and enduring works in music. He attempts to explain why she has produced no enduring musical work by essentially stating that although music is the highest expression of the emotions and that woman is emotional by nature, women just can't objectively look at and understand these emotions and therefore can't reproduce them in musical notation. Upton argues that to treat emotions as if they were mathematics, to bind and measure and limit them within the rigid laws of harmony and counterpoint, and to express them with arbitrary signs, is a cold-blooded operation, possible only to the sterner and more obdurate nature of man. This, of course, is pseudoscientific nonsense that has no basis in fact and is easily refuted by the many prolific and celebrated female composers and songwriters who lived and worked both before and since Upton's book. But this is Upton's theory, which he lays out in the first very short section of his book, before he moves on to the bulk of his thesis, which focuses on the various ways women have influenced the work of famous male composers. Now, Upton does acknowledge the work of both Fanny Mendelssohn and Clara Schumann, both female classical composers who lived and wrote during the 19th century, but simply dismisses their work as not very well known. And he actually uses both women as an example to prove that women have had equal advantages with men when it comes to creating music, and yet, nonetheless, have failed as creators. Upton doesn't seem to realize, however, that even these two celebrated and skilled composers, whose works are certainly well known today, faced numerous headwinds and pushback whenever they attempted to compose and create music. Upton fails to consider, it seems, that the contemporary attitude toward and expectations of women at the time led directly to unequal circumstances for women. And these expectations of women are very well realized in a couple of quotes concerning these two very famous female composers. Let's look first at Fanny Mendelssohn, who was born in Germany in 1805, and whose younger brother was the famous classical composer Felix Mendelssohn. Despite possessing impressive musical ability and a capacity for composing from an early age, her family warned against pursuing such activities in the way men could and, in the case of her brother Felix, would, to great acclaim. In 1820, her father wrote to her and said, "Music will perhaps become Felix's profession, while for you it can and must be only an ornament." And even her brother Felix once wrote, "Fanny regulates her house, and neither thinks of the public, nor of the musical world, nor even of music at all, until her first duties are fulfilled. Publishing would only disturb her in these, and I cannot say that I approve of it." And the situation was quite similar for Clara Schumann. Born Clara Wieck in 1819 in Germany, Clara was a child prodigy on the piano and began touring at age 11. Also at age 11, she began composing between 1 and 8 compositions every year. She went on to marry the famous composer Robert Schumann and began to face similar pushback to her composing. Robert once stated that, "To have children and a husband who is always living in the realm of imagination does not go together with composing. She cannot work at it regularly, and I am often disturbed to think how many profound ideas are lost because she cannot work them out." Now, while Fanny Mendelssohn and Clara Schumann wrote firmly in the classical tradition, the issues they faced as female composers are extremely similar to those faced by writers of popular music. After all, the pressures women faced to stay in line with the prevailing social norms of the day were the same, regardless of the type of music they sought to write. And yet, many women were able to overcome this disadvantage and are responsible for publishing thousands of Origipop songs between 1844 and 1964, many of which were hits at the time and some of which we still know and love today. So, let's take a look at some of these impressive women and their often still well-known hit songs. And let's start with Marion Dix Sullivan. Born in 1802, she wrote and published several songs in the 1840s and 50s, the most famous of which is the parlor song, The Blue Juniata, originally written for voice and guitar and published in 1844. This song is generally considered the first commercial hit song in America written by a woman and is mentioned in Mark Twain's autobiography when he describes the music he heard when he was younger and referenced with full lyrics in the classic novel, Little House on the Prairie. According to one analysis, while the melody and harmonies are relatively simple, like many parlor songs, the song also possesses a lively tone and occasionally snappy rhythms, which made it somewhat of a crossover song between the parlor songs of the time and the increasingly popular minstrel show music. Let's take a quick listen. The Juniata itself is actually a river in Pennsylvania, and the subject of the song deals with Native Americans, portraying them as the stereotypical noble savage, whose primitive purity is untarnished by modernity. This song, therefore, as popular as it was at the time, fits into an unfortunate practice of the era, which saw many songs, even those written by women, propagate many racist ideas. In fact, many of the female songwriters during this time wrote for minstrel shows, and many of their songs are, in fact, racist and offensive minstrel songs. And this continued even after the minstrel shows began to die away, as many of their songs then fell into the category of coon songs, which are essentially the successor to the earlier minstrel songs. However, the next female songwriter we'll look at rejected this type of music and its racist ideals. Augusta Brown was born in 1820 and eventually wrote over 200 songs, becoming known as one of the most prolific woman composers in America before 1870. One of her most famous songs is 1845's Wake Lady Mine, but she actually may have been better known as an author than as a songwriter. She wrote several books and articles, and her literary works circulated more widely than her musical works during her lifetime. And one of her most famous articles criticized the popular minstrel music of the mid-1800s. She wrote, "Why they are called Negro songs is a matter of marvel. The term is a libel on the whole colored race. No one at all acquainted with the unique and oft-times real poetry of genuine Negro nature could for one moment suppose the doggerels attached to these melodies to be correct delineations of Negro character." Brown further argued that the buffoonery and profanity found in the lyrics of popular minstrel songs were utterly antithetical to the educated speech of African-American oratory. So, in addition to defying the current norms surrounding women writing music, Augusta Brown also defied the extremely prevalent ideas about African-Americans' place in music and society overall, and as such, is truly a trailblazer and excellent example of an early female songwriter. Next, let's look at three non-American songwriters. First, there's Guy de Hartelot, a French composer whose real name was Helen Guy. Born in 1858, she studied music at the Conservatoire de Paris and then taught singing as she began to compose. She's an example of a female songwriter who published under a pen name. Now, I wasn't able to determine if this was done as a practical measure to help her music get published, but it should be mentioned that this was not uncommon, and many other women published either under pen names or simply under their initials, which would serve to obscure the fact that they were women. De Hartelot's most famous piece is probably Because, which is one of those songs, like many of De Hartelot's, that is somewhat of a crossover piece between light music or art song and the more simplistic Origipop song. Because was recorded in 1912 by the famous opera singer Enrico Caruso, and then by Mario Lanza, playing Caruso in the 1951 biopic The Great Caruso. A 1947 recording by Perry Como also reached the top of the charts, and more recently it can be heard in the second episode of the hilarious 1990s television program Jeeves and Wooster. Next, we'll look at the only songwriter on this list who was also royalty. Queen Liliuokalani was the only queen and the last monarch of the Hawaiian Kingdom, ruling from 1891 until the overthrow of the Hawaiian Kingdom in 1893. And she actually also wrote several songs, her most famous being the iconic and very well-known Hawaiian song, Aloha Oi. This song, known as Farewell to Thee in English, was written by Liliuokalani in 1878, when she was still a princess, and has become perhaps the most famous Hawaiian song, being featured in countless movies and television programs, and just generally a well-known part of our collective cultural consciousness. The last non-American we'll look at is Maria Grever, the first female Mexican songwriter to achieve widespread success. Grever studied music in France when she was young, where at one point one of her teachers was Claude Debussy, before moving to the U.S., where she became an American citizen and where she lived for the rest of her life. In addition to writing the music to her songs, she also wrote the lyrics, which would be primarily written originally in Spanish, and which would then later be translated into English for release in America. Some of her most popular songs are What a Difference a Day Made, published in 1934, and Magic is the Moonlight, heard in multiple films, including 1944's Bathing Beauty, starring Esther Williams, and 1950's Nancy Goes to Rio, starring Jane Powell. Next, let's start looking at the music of Tin Pan Alley, which was the area of New York City fast becoming the music center of the United States in the 1880s and 90s. Another song that is still quite well known even today is 1899's Hello My Baby. This song was written by husband and wife songwriting team Ida Emerson and Joseph E. Howard, who published songs as Howard and Emerson. This song is perhaps best known for its use in the 1955 Warner Brothers short, One Froggy Evening.
Hello, my baby. Hello, my honey. Hello, my ragtime gal. Send me a kiss by wire. Baby, my heart's on fire. If you refuse me, honey, you lose me. Then you'll be left alone. Oh, baby, telephone and tell me I'm your own.
And probably because of its use in this short, this is one of the most recognized early Tin Pan Alley songs today. Interestingly, that short also features two other songs written, at least in part, by women. Come Back to Erin, written in 1866, is an Irish-themed song written by English songwriter Charlotte Allington Bernard, more commonly known as Claribel. This song is heard in One Froggy Evening after the man and frog get kicked out of the theatrical agencies. It is also heard in the 1990 Coen Brothers film Miller's Crossing. Also heard in One Froggy Evening is the 1930 song Please Don't Talk About Me When I'm Gone, which might have been co-written by Bee Palmer, a popular singer and dancer who was known as the Shimmy Queen. The authorship of this song is a little confusing, as some copies of sheet music list only Sam Stepped and Sidney Clare as the creators, while others also list Bee Palmer. Regardless, the number of songs in this short written by women is still impressive and simply serves to highlight the impact female composers had long after their songs were first published. But in addition to attaining longevity and success in the future, there were also many songs written by women which achieved huge success during the time in which they were written. In fact, within about a decade, right around the turn of the 20th century, there were 4 songs published by women which all sold over 1 million copies of sheet music. In 1894, Anita Owen wrote Sweet Bunch of Daisies. This was followed in 1896 by Sweet Rosie O'Grady by singer-songwriter Maud Nugent. Then in 1901, Carrie Jacobs Bond published I Love You Truly. And finally, Claire Coomer wrote Deary in 1905. Furthermore, all of these songs had both music and lyrics written by their respective songwriters. Despite this being fairly common, as many of the songs we've looked at so far prove, it apparently was hard for some men to believe that a woman could do both. Claire Coomer said that after she wrote both music and lyrics to 1903's Egypt, she had to pretend that the music and lyrics were written by 2 people because someone had said it was out of the question that I could do both. Some of these million-seller songs also managed to be both successful in their day and years later as well. I Love You Truly has been used numerous times in television and movies, including one of my favorite movies, It's a Wonderful Life, where it is sung by Bert and Ernie, no, not those ones, the other ones. Yeah, that's right. To newlyweds George and Mary Bailey.
I love you.
And more recently, it can be heard in the Oscar-winning film, The King's Speech, from 2010. And Maude Nugent's Sweet Rosie O'Grady gained renewed popularity in the 1940s and 50s, when many songs from the gay 90s found new life as people looked back at these songs with a sense of nostalgia. This song specifically reached new audiences when it was performed on television by Nugent herself on The Ed Sullivan Show in 1949 and then again in 54.
My dear little rose, she's my steady lady, most everyone knows.
This song can also be heard multiple times a day, every day, on Disneyland's Main Street Music Loop. A few years later, 2 other female songwriters rose to prominence with a couple of hit songs. In 1908, Nora Bayes, a popular singer who wrote several songs with her then-husband Jack Norworth, wrote their most successful hit, Shine On Harvest Moon. Although she wrote dozens of songs, she was much more well-known as a singer and performer and for her unconventional private life. Called the Beyoncé of her day by one modern commentator, she performed in the Ziegfeld Follies, was the first person to record George M. Cohen's Over There, and perform Take Me Out to the Ballgame. She was called the Queen of Vaudeville and Musical Comedy, and she was even the first woman to have a Broadway theater named after her. Bayes also refused to follow the social expectations regarding how women should behave at the time. She was divorced 5 times, which was often covered extensively by the press, and she is quoted as giving out the following advice to other wives. As soon as one becomes bored, one should secure divorce. She also walked out of contracts and strongly resisted managerial control, largely relying on her own charisma and popularity to get ahead. Although her impact in the area of Origipop came primarily from singing and performing, she was still one of the most well-known female composers during her time. At around the same time, another female songwriter, who was conversely known more for her songs than her personal life, wrote two hugely popular works. In 1909, lyricist Beth Slater Whitson published Meet Me Tonight in Dreamland, and then followed that up the next year with Let Me Call You Sweetheart, both of which featured music by Leo Friedman. Both of these songs were massive hits in their day and maintained their popularity very well over the next several decades. Meet Me Tonight in Dreamland was featured prominently in the 1949 Judy Garland film In the Good Old Summertime, the first musical version of You've Got Mail, based on the earlier Shop Around the Corner.
How about this, madam? You might like it. Lovely lyrics and all.
No, this. Dreamland.
Meet me tonight in Dreamland.
Yeah.
Could
some... Yes, may I?
Thank you.
Go.
Isn't it pretty?
Yeah. Please, madam, have a seat.
Meet me tonight in dreamland, under the silvery moon. Meet me tonight in dreamland, where love's sweet roses bloom.
And a recording of Let Me Call You Sweetheart was selected in 2015 by the Library of Congress as an addition to the National Recording Registry, and the song has been heard in various movies and on television numerous times over the past several years, and is another song heard on Disneyland's Main Street. And although these are Whitson's most popular and well-known hits, she composed lyrics to over 400 songs, making her one of the most prolific female songwriters from this time. Next, I'd like to look at a couple of songwriters who faced discrimination on two fronts. One, because they were women, and two, because they were black. Lillian Hardin Armstrong was a jazz pianist and singer who also found success as a composer, arranger, and bandleader. She learned piano as a child and early on worked in a music store playing sheet music on the piano to demonstrate it to customers, kind of like we saw Judy Garland do in the Good Old Summertime. After this, she joined a few different jazz bands and orchestras, and it was in one of these that she met Louis Armstrong, and they ended up getting married in 1924. Although they eventually separated, she would continue to use his last name, often having her name listed as Lil Armstrong. She eventually led her own band and also wrote several songs, including Just for a Thrill in 1932 and Bad Boy, originally titled Brown Gal, in 1936, both of which gained renewed success years later from covers, the former by Ray Charles and the latter by Ringo Starr. Another black female songwriter was Lovey Austin. Austin was also a skilled pianist who found early success in vaudeville and later on accompanying blues singers and also leading her own band. She wrote the music to many blues songs, including several that she wrote with singer and lyricist Alberta Hunter, such as Chirpin' the Blues and Downhearted Blues. The version of Downhearted Blues, sung by Bessie Smith, was incredibly popular when it was released in 1923 and was selected by the Library of Congress as an addition to the National Recording Registry in its inaugural year in 2002. Although Austin performed and wrote less as the classic blues era wound down in the 30s, her impact as a songwriter continued as she inspired future black women to write and perform music. In fact, Mary Lou Williams, another famous black female pianist, arranger, and composer, said that Lovey Austin was her greatest influence. And Williams went on to arrange for Duke Ellington and Benny Goodman, record over 100 records, and write several songs as well, including Little Joe from Chicago and Walkin' and Swingin'. The next several songwriters we'll cover are a bit more well-known, and so because of this and in the interest of time, I'm going to cover some of them a bit quicker. Ann Ronnell had hits with Willow Weep for Me and Who's Afraid of the Big Bad Wolf from the 1933 Disney short The Three Little Pigs. She was also nominated in 1945 for both Best Song and Best Score for The Story of G.I. Joe. Peggy Lee was primarily known as a singer and performer, but also wrote over 250 songs, including all the songs, along with co-writer Sonny Burke, for the 1955 Disney film Lady and the Tramp. Dana Suisse was an excellent pianist who wrote several Origipop songs, including The Night is Young and You're So Beautiful, which can be heard in the 1993 Mel Brooks comedy Robin Hood Men in Tights. But, like George Gershwin, to whom she was often compared, Suisse was also skilled enough to write more serious classical pieces, and did so often. Kay Swift also had a more classical background, but after meeting George Gershwin, began to write more Origipop songs. Her best-known songs are Can't We Be Friends and Fine and Dandy, the latter of which was written for a show of the same name, whose score was also written by Kay Swift. And in fact, the show Fine and Dandy was actually the first successful Broadway musical to feature a complete score by a female composer. Betty Comden, alongside her writing partner Adolph Green, contributed to numerous Hollywood musicals and Broadway shows, primarily as a writer of scripts, but also through the writing of lyrics to several popular songs featured in their shows. Some of their songs include the only new song written for the hit musical film Singin' in the Rain, the iconic and upbeat Moses Supposes, as well as the most famous song from the musical On the Town, New York, New York. Sylvia Fine was married to famous actor and comedian Danny Kaye and wrote the music and lyrics to many of the songs he performed in his films. She was also nominated for 2 Oscars for Best Original Song, first for the title song for the 1953 film The Moon is Blue, then for the title song for the 1959 Danny Kaye film The 5 Pennies. And we'll end this look at female songwriters by talking about perhaps the most successful and famous of these female songwriters, Dorothy Fields. Fields first began writing songs with composer Jimmy McHugh, penning several early hits including I Can't Give You Anything But Love in 1928 and On the Sunny Side of the Street in 1930. Then in the mid-1930s, she teamed up with legendary composer Jerome Kern for work on 2 Fred Astaire Ginger Rogers films, Roberta and Swing Time. Among the songs for which Fields provided lyrics in these films are I Won't Dance, Lovely to Look At, Pick Yourself Up, A Fine Romance, and The Way You Look Tonight, which ended up winning the Academy Award for Best Original Song in 1937.
Someday, when I'm awfully low and the world is cold, I will feel a glow just thinking of you and the way you look tonight.
In the 40s, she had an idea for a show based on the life of famous female sharpshooter Annie Oakley and ended up writing the script for the musical Annie Get Your Gun. She wrote both book and lyrics for the 1959 Broadway musical Redhead, which won 6 Tonys, and had her last hit, although not her last show, providing lyrics for 1966 Sweet Charity, which featured the songs Big Spender and If My Friends Could See Me Now. Fields was incredibly successful, and her impact reached decades beyond her life and well outside of just the realm of Origipop and theater, when a line from her Swing Time song Pick Yourself Up made it into Barack Obama's inauguration speech in 2009, when he said,
"Starting today, we must pick ourselves up, dust ourselves off, and begin again the work of remaking America."
But Fields' success didn't come about in a vacuum or through only her good luck or skill. Her accomplishments are due in large part to the strong tradition of female songwriters who rejected sexist ideas and the conventional attitudes and pressures of the day, which worked to restrict women to just performing or teaching music. There were literally thousands of women who broke these barriers and created both music and lyrics to give us timeless and beautiful songs, and whose successes have opened the door for women and girls today to be able to follow in their footsteps and create beautiful songs and music. And to all of them, I say thank you. And to everyone else, thanks for watching.
Nothing's impossible, I have found. When my chin is on the ground, I pick myself up, dust myself off, start all over again. Don't lose your confidence if you slip. Be grateful for a pleasant trip and pick yourself up, dust yourself off, start all over again.